Good morning and welcome to another time in the Word here. We're working through 1 Samuel. This is an amazing chapter today, 1 Samuel 28. So please open your Bible to that chapter right now. Scared? Boy, when I was little, loved watching scary movies. Those were the days. The days when we would just wait for Saturday night to watch Creature Features. I'm a little kid. I'm excited about getting scared. Never cared for slasher movies. But boy, to watch Creature Features. Take a look at the intro to Creature Features. Now, boy, we love that stuff. That came on WGN Chicago Saturday nights. Boy, that would really prepare you for church. But boy, we loved it. We loved the Wolfman and Dracula and Hunchback of Notre Dame, Creature from the Black Lagoon, and one of my favorites, Frankenstein. Isn't that guy, you think about it, always cool. Frankenstein was always cool. I mean, he wore a suit wherever he went. Well, that's class, all right? The Mummy, there's another guy. And we would watch this and want to be scared. Well, the chapter we're looking at today is that kind of chapter. This could be on Creature Features. A witch shows up and we start to see, or continue to see, the demise of King Saul. So I want to pray and then get into our time together. So let's do that. Father, thank you for another opportunity to look into your word. Thank you for your patience with us. We read these stories, and a lot of times we look a lot like these men and women in the Bible. So glad you're not still putting together the canon of Scripture for others to read about our stuff. But we are accountable, and I'm asking you now that as we're looking into your Word, as we're drawing close to you, Lord, you'd use this time that we would be a brave people, a courageous people, a hope-filled people. We pray all this thanking you in Jesus' name. Amen. So I've already talked about some things that brought fear, that scared me, and I'd like to talk a little bit about not fear, but hopelessness. Take a listen from John Woodhouse as he's in this book, 1 Samuel, looking for a leader. Very, very good commentator on this. He says, utter hopelessness is the darkest of all human experiences. It is the realization that there is absolutely no prospect of a future with anything positive in it. Hopelessness, when it overcomes a person, strips away motivation or enthusiasm for living because there is nothing, absolutely nothing good to look forward to. Even fear is better than hopelessness. When we're afraid, we usually dread something that could happen or that may be as bad as we imagine, that there is usually also the possibility that things will turn out better than we expect. There is, in other words, hope. Hopelessness is the experience of believing there is no future worth having. So this is where we find King Saul. This is where we find him, in a hopeless state. And so I want to go to the passage here, 1 Samuel 28. I hope you have your Bible open to that. And I want you to notice something at the beginning. It's actually almost an attachment to 1 Samuel 27. Point number one, sad desperation. Sad desperation. Look at verses 1 and 2 of chapter 28. In those days, the Philistines gathered their forces for war to fight against Israel. And Achish said to David, understand that you and your men are to go out with me in the army. David said to Achish, very well, you shall know what your servant can do. And Achish said to David, very well, I will make you my bodyguard for life. Now, think back to what we talked about last time we were together. Remember, David had backslidden. David had, on a regular basis, he's been lying to this king of the Philistines, Achish. And he's been saying, I've been attacking my own people. So David is saying, I'm attacking Israelites in the Negev of these different areas here in the south. And Achish believes him. Achish believes in what David is telling him. And so finally we get to this first verse of chapter 28, and David's bluff is finally called. We're going to see what cards you are holding, David. And so he says to him, now you're going to go out with me and fight your own people. And David says this line, enjoy this with me. Very well, you shall know what your servant can do. Now, that's really not answering anything. That says a lot. You're really going to see. I've been watching you, David, Achish says. And you've been fighting your own people, and I trust you. Now we're going to war against the Israelites, and I want you and your men to join us. So, uh-oh. Were you counting on this, David? Talk about scared. When you backslid, when you started to head into enemy territory, were you counting on this when you cut yourself off from your own people? When you went into Philistine country? Far from your own people? Well, there's always a price to pay. And David just made that sly comment that you could read a bunch of different ways. We're finding out that David more and more is learning how to deceive. And so now we are kind of left there. And by the way, David was supposed to be Saul's bodyguard. But we leave, and the lens now turns to Saul. So we've kind of going back and forth here. And now we're going to learn some more things about Saul. Look at verse 3. Now Samuel had died, and all Israel had mourned for him and buried him in Ramah, his own city. And Saul had put the mediums and the necromancers out of the land. So we see Saul taking steps that we would think would be God-honoring. Let me tell you a little bit about mediums. A medium claimed to be able to conjure up and consult the spirit of a dead person, perhaps using ventriloquism to convince the gullible that they had contacted the departed. A necromancer, or it could be translated a knowing one, claimed to possess knowledge through access to the spirits of the dead. As the narrative later reads, Saul's efforts in dealing with this phenomenon, as in other expressions of his commitment to the standards of the Lord, fall short of total success. So he says, I'm going to get rid of them. Now, another thing I want you to think about is Saul usually was not making decisions based on the glory of God. This is something that was commanded, and in a moment we'll look at the different verses that commanded that. This is commanded by God. They should have nothing to do with this. But we're going to see Saul head this direction. But he demands that all of these type of individuals be out of the kingdom. Why? Could it be that Saul, if you remember early on in our study with 1 Samuel, early on, he was tormented. He was tormented by evil spirits. And so, how can I get rid of these evil spirits? Well, one thing in particular, I can get rid of the people that have anything to do with this. So, it is not necessarily for the glory of God, because most of the time, the decisions he's making aren't that. It could be purely selfish. And this happens sometimes. There are times we have no interest in things of the Lord. We'll make a decision that people look at and go, that's a good decision, but we're making it based on something that's affecting us. Now I'm taking that thing seriously. Now I'm taking that ministry seriously. Up to this point, I had no interest in that. And I get that. We get that. But to have a sensitivity to all types of things going on, that people hurt in all different areas of life. It's not just the one that we're passionate about because of what we're going through, but that God has that in the Word for a reason. We shouldn't be consulting those people. We shouldn't be messing around with that. Well, look at, so he says he's going to banish them. Verse 4, the Philistines assembled and came and encamped at Shunem, and Saul gathered all Israel, and they encamped at Gilboa. When Saul saw that the army of the Philistines, when he saw it, he was afraid, and his heart trembled greatly. So, that the war between the Philistines and Saul was to take place in that northern city of Gilboa meant that the Philistines had penetrated deeply into Israel, and that Saul was boxed in. So no wonder his heart is trembling. Now, how did that happen? How did Saul lose control of the land of Israel? There's a very simple reason, and you know it too. He was spending his time fighting the wrong enemy. He was chasing David. So now, when there is a real war to fight, a genuine war to fight, he is completely, totally unprepared. And the same thing can happen to us. If we get all tangled up in the little problems that arise among Christians, when it comes time to do battle against our true enemy, we're going to be powerless. And so we have Samuel is dead, and we know that from chapter 25 of 1 Samuel. We learn that Saul kicks out the occultists, most likely for a selfish reason. And here are the biblical reasons, so that you know there, it's a good thing that he did this. But we always want to look at motives and why somebody does what they do. Leviticus 19:31. Do not turn to mediums or necromancers. Do not seek them out, and so make yourselves unclean by them. I am the Lord your God. Leviticus 20, verse 6. If a person turns to mediums and necromancers, whoring after them, I will set my face against that person and will cut him off from among his people. Leviticus 20, verse 27. A man or a woman who is a medium or a necromancer shall surely be put to death. They shall be stoned with stones. Their blood shall be upon them. And then Deuteronomy 18:10-12. There shall be not found among you anyone who burns his son or his daughter as an offering. Anyone who practices divination or tells fortunes or interprets omens or a sorcerer or a charmer or a medium or a necromancer or one who inquires of the dead. For whoever does these things is an abomination to the Lord. And because of these abominations, the Lord your God is driving them out before you. This is commanded of the people of Israel by Yahweh, by God. Don't mess with this stuff. So I want to encourage you. Don't play with this. Ouija boards, astrology, horoscopes, these things that we take lightly. I know Christians that dabble in this stuff. Why? Why are you checking it? Why are you even looking at that stuff? This is what we look to for what is in our lives. And so we get all of the background here. Saul has put them out. Saul is cornered by the Philistines, who he's terrified of. And all this time he could have had the armor bearer next to him that always wins against the Philistines. But he's been chasing that guy. The power of jealousy. And then we see why we're going to get where we're going. Look at verse 6. And when Saul inquired of the Lord did not answer him, either by dreams or by Urim or by prophets. God was not speaking to Saul through dreams. He says here, through Urim. Well, why does he even do that? He doesn't even mention the word priests here, because what did Saul do with the priests? He slaughtered them. Or by prophets. He shut down the prophet. He shut down the priests. He's doing things his way. And this is what happens. And so we can be the same way. We've got this idea in the New Testament era, the age of grace, that no matter how we live, we're always good with God. But we can grieve his heart. We can break his heart. We can head a wrong direction. And that has ramifications for our life. We should not play with this stuff, but we should also not play with not listening to God. And that's what's happened here. You're not going to listen to me anyways, Saul, so I'm not going to talk to you. So instead of calling out to the Lord, instead of repenting, instead of getting on his face and waiting on the Lord, instead of turning from his pursuit of David and truly changing, we see Saul make point number two, a sad decision. Look at verse 7. Then Saul said to his servants, seek out for me a woman who is a medium, that I may go to her and inquire of her. So in Saul's desperation, he sought the very source that he had removed from the land. And in spite of that, look what happens here. And his servant said to him, behold, there is a medium at Endor. Now, think of it. How quickly he responds. His servant. Oh, yeah, I know. Wait, hold on. Weren't they supposed to be kicked out of the land? It should have taken a while. Okay, we'll get on that. We'll find what we need to find. By the way, I want you to know something here. Remember her from the show Bewitched? Remember, what was her name? Do you remember her name? Yeah. Endora. You don't tell me that TV writers don't know their Old Testament, all right? There's biblical themes throughout even the secular media, the secular pop culture. And you'll notice them because these people know some of the stuff. They don't necessarily know the stuff that's going to change their life, because we don't want that, but we're going to do plays on words. And they look at the Bible as literature. So I want you to notice that there was a biblical reference even in a sitcom from back in the day. So this servant knows exactly where there's one, and Endor is located about 3.5 miles northwest of Shunem, between Mount Tabor and the hill of Moreh. And so Saul risks his life by venturing into Philistine-held territory to seek out the counsel of a medium. He goes in disguise. We see point number three, sad disguise. Look at verse 8. So Saul disguised himself. Isn't that interesting when we start walking away from God and we don't want people to know what we're doing, we're hiding? So Saul disguised himself and put on other garments and went, he and two men with him, and they came to the woman by night, and he said, divine for me by a spirit, and bring up for me whomever I shall name to you. So under the cover of darkness, he seeks help from a psychic. We even hear later in the book of Isaiah, chapter 8, verse 19, says this, and when they say to you, inquire of the mediums and the necromancers who chirp and mutter. Now think about that. God's word is plain and clear. Who chirp and mutter, should not a people inquire of their God? Should they inquire of the dead on behalf of the living? This is what you've stooped to? And so to escape the notice of the enemy and even his own troops, and also to deceive the medium, the king removes his royal robes. And with these two companions, he makes his way to the medium by night, which was possibly the usual time for these seances, and would also help conceal his movements. And he asks the woman to divine for me by a spirit. Divine is the most general term for engaging in occult practices. And Saul is requesting a seance during which he will name a specific individual to be called up from the realm of the dead. So this is what's happening here. He's going into the area of death. You think about those old monster movies. Dracula has been dead for years. The mummy has been dead for years. Frankenstein. It's all death. And this scares us. This unknown scares us. Point number four, a sad development. Look at verse 9. The woman said to him, now he's talking to the witch is talking to him, surely you know what Saul has done, how he has cut off the mediums and the necromancers from the land. Why then are you laying a trap for my life to bring about my death? But Saul swore to her by the Lord, as the Lord lives, now think about him using those words, no punishment shall come upon you for this thing. So how low are you going to go, Saul? God is not speaking to you, and instead of repenting before him, you're going to a psychic. And this is not innocent, because the Bible, as we've already read, specifically tells us we are to stay away and not have anything to do with these activities involving necromancy. And then it's blasphemous how Saul includes God's name in this exchange. But this is where Saul is at. He can do this. He can mix God with whatever he wants to get his way. And so we see these steps being taken. Verse 11, then the woman said, whom shall I bring up for you? He said, bring up Samuel for me. When the woman saw Samuel, she cried out with a loud voice. And the woman said to Saul, why have you deceived me? You are Saul. So we see here, through her shriek, evidence of not being prepared to see what has happened here. A lot of people have debated, did Samuel really come up at this time? I believe he did. But I believe it had very little to do with this woman. I think there are people that traffic in this. I think there are people that mess with this. And you even notice in the context here how God is careful not even to tell us how this happens. He just states in his word that it happens because he doesn't want to give tips on how to take the steps to do this stuff. God doesn't want us messing with it. And I believe what happened on a regular basis with this kind of stuff is the people are not called up. Demons masquerade. We see that even in the New Testament when we hear about the idolatry. Because if somebody did come back from heaven or hell, and we would assume that Samuel is in paradise, in Abraham's bosom, in the good place, that anybody that would be called back, that would be from a good place, would warn the person, or if a person was called back from torment, that they would warn the person. But you never hear those stories. Oh, they're doing fine. Yeah, they wanted to know how Billy was, and they go through all of these things because it's demonic. But we see here a different thing happens, and she shrieks, she screams because this doesn't happen. And then she's very much aware of the fact that, hey, you're Saul. She wasn't expecting this to happen. She was going to either play her game or she was going to get news from a demon as she had in the past. That's where she trafficked. And now this man of God comes to her face to face. And this is a whole new ballgame. It's a whole different thing. Look at verse 13. The king said to her, do not be afraid. What do you see? So it sounds like he can't see. Maybe he can hear some things. But she can see Samuel. And the woman said to Saul, I see a God coming out of the earth, coming up out of the earth. That word God there, little g, is the word Elohim. It's a God-like person. And so that's how she views it. She's not a person of God. She's just trying to make sense of this thing. And he said to her, so this is Saul talking to the witch, what is his appearance? And she said, an old man is coming up and he's wrapped in a robe. And Saul knew that it was Samuel. And he bowed with his face to the ground and paid homage. So we see here, he's not knowing what to do. What should I do? Saul says to Samuel in desperation, and Samuel never tells Saul what he should do. Instead, he says what's going to happen. We're going to see the dialogue back and forth between Saul and Samuel. This appearance, old man in a robe, and Saul would know about that robe. That's the robe that he grabbed and tore. That's the robe. You think about how much we've heard about Samuel's robe, how even as a little boy, his mom would make a priestly robe for him. And so what he wore said much. And it's also that prophetic mantle, that prophetic robe that he's going to give the word of God to Saul. Nothing's changed. It's not like he calls him up and there's going to be a whole new message. He had all that time in life to talk to Samuel. And so he truly now knows who his friend is again. So we see verse 15. Then Samuel said to Saul, "Why have you disturbed me by bringing me up?" That's a further evidence that when we are in paradise, when we are absent from the body, present with the Lord, we are going to be so done with this earth. Obviously we care, but when we're in heaven, oh, to be in glory. And that's Samuel. What have you done? Saul answered, I am in great distress, for the Philistines are warring against me, and God has turned away from me and answers me no more. Saul, do you think Samuel's going to say anything different than what God has said? Either by prophets or by dreams. He isn't even mentioning the priests because we know what he did. Therefore, this is why, Samuel, therefore I have summoned you to tell me what I shall do. And Samuel said, why then do you ask me? Since the Lord has turned from you and become your enemy. I'm not going to say anything different, Saul. Why are you bugging me? You really don't want to do what God says. Verse 17, the Lord has done to you as he spoke by me. I've told you this when I was alive. For the Lord has torn the kingdom out of your hand and given it to your neighbor David. So now he's named. Now David's named. Because, listen to why this is happening, Saul. Because you did not obey the voice of the Lord and did not carry out his fierce wrath against Amalek. Therefore, the Lord has done this thing to you this day. I told you, remember that day you tore my robe? You wouldn't kill Agag. I had to take care of that. Nothing's changed. You truly haven't repented. Moreover, the Lord will give Israel also with you into the hand of the Philistines. And tomorrow you and your sons shall be with me. Wow. The Lord will give the army of Israel also into the hand of the Philistines. So, you should have destroyed the Amalekites. Nothing's changed. And furthermore, you and your sons will die tomorrow. He's a prophet. He's calling it. And the Lord is mentioned 7 times in Samuel's reply. Nothing's changed, Saul. I'm still a spokesman for the Lord. You just don't listen. Verse 20. Then Saul fell at once full length on the ground, filled with fear because of the words of Samuel. And there was no strength in him, for he had eaten nothing all day and all night. And the woman came to Saul. So maybe she had stepped out. Maybe she just watched, or maybe now she's moving towards Saul. And the woman came to Saul, and when she saw that he was terrified, she said to him, "Behold, your servant has obeyed you. I have taken my life in my hand and have listened to what you have said to me." So this, she's looking for some self-preservation here. "Now therefore, you also obey your servant. Let me set a morsel of bread before you and eat, that you may have strength when you go on your way." So this kindness to Saul may have been due to the fact that if he had died in her house, she would be in bigger trouble, since witches were outlawed. And we see here, as we see this conversation going on, that he has not eaten. Look at verse 23. He refused and said, I will not eat. But his servants, together with the woman, urged him, and he listened to their words. So he arose from the earth and sat on the bed. Now the woman had a fattened calf in the house, so this medium must be paid well. And she quickly killed it, and she took flour and kneaded it and baked unleavened bread of it. And she put it before Saul and his servants, and they ate. Then they rose and went away that night. So this woman fixes him a meal that's fit for a king. But it's almost, in fact, it is like his last request, his last meal, because tomorrow he's going to die. And he slips away into the night. And the next time we read of him, he'll be in the battle that will take his life. Now, what a sad chapter. He's become someone that has become hopeless. Where does this chapter find you today? This made me think of a song. If you remember this song by the Beatles, it was off the album Rubber Soul. And John Lennon was hours trying to write a song, one more song for this album. He says, I'd spent 5 hours that morning trying to write a song that was meaningful and good, and I finally gave up and laid down. So he finally just goes and lays down. And then this song came to his mind. And the whole thing was, as he's laying there. McCartney said of the song, that was John after a night out with dawn coming up. I think at that point he was a bit wondering where he was going, and to be truthful, so was I. I was starting to worry about him. Listen to the words of this song. If you remember this. He's a real nowhere man, sitting in his nowhere land, making all his nowhere plans for nobody. Doesn't have a point of view, knows not where he's going to. Isn't he a bit like you and me? Then it goes on and says, nowhere man, please listen. You don't know what you're missing. Nowhere man, the world is at your command. He goes on, he says, he's as blind as he can be, just sees what he wants to see. Nowhere man, can you see me at all? Nowhere man, don't worry, take your time, don't hurry, leave it all till somebody else lends you a hand. Doesn't have a point of view, knows not where he's going to. Isn't he a bit like you and me? Saul is a nowhere man. He's turned over and completely gone to the dark side. Where does this message find you? This isn't a game that's being played. Do you have 1 foot in to things of life and 1 foot in things of death? God wants us to be people that are focused and looking to him who is life eternal. So I want to encourage you today in your walk that if there's something you need to turn from, then turn from it. Anything apart from Christ isn't worthwhile. And he gives purpose and he gives hope. And I want to encourage you today to be a person of hope. Let's pray. Father, I don't know, once again, where this message finds each and every person listening to it, but you do. And so it's got a scary story here. But even in the midst of something scary, that fear could push us to something good. I'm asking, God, for those that are here that are like Saul today, and they're feeling hopeless. They don't see any way out. And I'm asking you, God, to shine a light to the truth, that they would surround themselves with the people that would point them the right direction instead of going deeper into things of darkness. Please, God, help us to learn from Saul. And thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.